So thank you very much for coming to my presentation. I guess the reason why I'm, hi. I guess I'm taking this opportunity to talk about something that is quite near and dear to my heart as the data manager at Homeward Trust, which is the final product of whatever it is that we do with our data and with research. I feel like the word data gets thrown around all the time. Everybody wants data. Nobody, half of the people don't even know what data is. Data is anything from something quantitative to something that we must have because our bosses want more data and let's show data and data is the new black. So in especially over the past 10 years, you know, I've sort of seen in my career beforehand, just a little bit of a background, I'm an economist, so I used to work as a consultant, and I consulted for the government of Alberta, the federal government, the city of Edmonton, private sector, all over. So I've seen a lot of what people do and don't do with their data. So in this presentation, I'm going to sort of talk a little bit about what you should keep in mind when you're presenting data. And this doesn't mean that you're the primary researcher, you've got a problem, but just even people who are putting out you know, someone who's putting out a memo to their boss, like somebody who's putting together a presentation, I think we've all sort of been locked into this feeling that data needs to be shown in a default Excel graph, and that that somehow meets some sort of visual standards. But it's not. We now have 5 times more information that we need to process than in 1986. I just saw a statistic that 90% of the information that we currently have around has been generated in the last 2 years. So there's just like so much stuff out there. And what do people do? You know, they tune it out, right? So how do we get anything across to them quantitatively? So, okay, going back to the slide for a sec before the next one. So I've sort of seen three over the past 10 years, both in my sort of, both at the university and in my job as a consultant, and I've seen sort of three main approaches to data. One is this like data, let's get data, let's try to look like we're measuring everything, like everything's quantitative, and this is kind of the result of this kind of an approach. I saw this chart and I just thought, why is this a chart? Why? Who ever thought that this was a good idea? It's like the drinking ages across Canada. Basically, the message is 3 provinces have 18 years old as their drinking age, and 7 are 19, right? Why is this a graph? But that's that approach, you know? And so you see this. You see people putting up presentations. You see, you get a memo, you get a report, and you look and you see graphs like this, right? What does that do? Nothing. It just creates like more. It takes up real estate on a page, which is actually why I think is a big reason why people follow this approach. But it also, more importantly, it takes away from whatever you are trying to say. Because everything that we process, everything that we look at takes up brain energy. And we only have a limited amount of brain energy. So do you want people using their brain energy, like going through clutter, seeing things that don't matter? Or do you want to focus them on, you know, focus them on where you want them to go? So a second kind of common approach I see in data is this showing too much data. It's this like, oh my gosh, well, we just did a study. We have so much data. We have everything, you know, down to like 10 numbers after the decimal. And then you get this. What does this even say? Again, you know, you've like, I don't understand. So basically, I think what they're trying to say after spending like 5 minutes looking at this chart, what they're trying to say is that, you know, 96% of the people who own Bitcoin own only less than 4%, whereas 4% of the people who own Bitcoin own 96% of it. Like, that's it. You know, sentence, right, like two numbers, right? And do we ever, I'm sorry, but like anytime I see 95.89% versus 3.47, do you need those numbers after the decimal? Like, is that more effective than saying 96 versus 4? Right? You never need numbers. I mean, very, very infrequently do you need like 10 numbers after the decimal. So the third approach, and I'm guilty of this, is putting not enough information on a chart. And we do that when we've spent a lot of time working with some data and we've thought it through and we think that whatever we're showing, everybody is going to infer all the things that we've inferred having sat in this for, you know, days, weeks, sometimes even years. And that's, I find myself sometimes putting things out and then somebody coming back and saying, okay, so is there more women or men in this? And like, why does it matter? And I'm like, whoa. You know, and then I realized people don't have the same context. So those are kind of three common themes that I see in terms of making, and I'm guilty and have been probably of each one of these approaches at some point in my life. So how do we fix that? How do we, what can we do, you know, in order to make sure that if we are putting data, it's meaningful, and if it is meaningful, that we're making sure that the people who are seeing it are understanding it and are getting the message that they want from it. So I'm going to talk about sort of three things to keep in mind. The first one is harness design principles and pre-attentive attributes to make information more digestible. That sounds kind of complicated because I'm using this sort of data visualization faddish phrase, which are pre-attentive attributes. But what that actually means is that we're programmed in our brains to very quickly understand certain visual cues. So we understand, for example, that if we see something and the color red, the red is there to grab our attention. If we see even a hexagon, we know that this is going to be a warning because we associate it with a stop sign. And those are things that take our brain milliseconds to process. So I don't need to tell you. When we see something that's longer, if we see, for example, a bar chart, if we see something that's longer and something that's shorter, we instantly know which one is bigger than the other. We don't have to spend any of our brain power processing that. So using those pre-attentive attributes, which I'll talk a little bit about later, in order to focus our audience is very important. And using design principles. Again, I go back to this horror that has been caused by default Excel graphs. Just because Excel spits it out in a particular way, that doesn't mean it's following good design principles, even especially when you're showing data or quantitative numbers, which are not intuitive for people. That's when you have to make it as easy for them to read, as easy for them to digest, and as easy for them to absorb. So, you know, I think especially when you're dealing with numbers, you should think of design. Be mindful of the question the data is meant to answer or the story is meant to tell. So when you're looking at a chart or a graph that you're putting out, like, what question is it answering? Because if it's not answering a question, it doesn't need to be there. And think about your end product. Again, I feel like people spend a lot of time thinking when they're doing research or when they're doing analysis, they spend a lot of time like working with numbers kind of at the front end. And then thinking about it and analyzing, and so little time at the end thinking how they're going to present it. And that's the only way it's going to matter. It doesn't matter if you spend all this time and become an absolute expert in this. If you're unable to communicate it to somebody who's able to take that and either make it into policy or do something with it, it doesn't matter. It's like our boss always says, she's like, if you guys are doing stuff and nobody knows about it, it doesn't matter. And she's right, you know. So the pre-attentive attributes. So, like I said, these are visual cues that process by your brains in milliseconds. And the more we can leverage them to tell a story, the more complex is the story we can tell. So, some of the length is So this chart from this book, Information Visualization, shows the different visual cues and categorizes them according to how good they are at showing quantitative information. So really the best way to show quantitative information is by bars, because people can really easily compare bars. They very quickly look at a bar chart and they know which is the biggest, which is the smallest. And they're pretty good too at being able to see magnitude. Like if you see a bar like this and if you see a bar like this, you know that this one is about twice as big as the other one. So position as well. When you look at those four dots, you know which one is the lowest. You know which one is the highest. So very quickly you're able to communicate things like, you know, rank, like even the relative sort of size, especially when you use bars, without having to use up anyone's brain power. So if you can communicate those things using those attributes. The less precise ones are width. So when you're thinking about, you know, when you're choosing a chart and you're thinking, well, maybe I'll show this bigger thing as a wider rather than a narrower, people aren't that good at being able to see that this is twice as wide. But they're much better at seeing that something is twice as long. So if you want them to kind of compare, you want to go for length, right? Not so much for width. Same with size. Okay, you can see that that's bigger, but it's really hard for you to see if that's a third bigger, if that's twice as big, if that's, you know, it's, and same, this is the problem with using pie charts. Like, people don't do area well. So it's really hard for them to compare one area and another area and see, like, and see which one is how much bigger than the other one. So, and then the other ones, like blur and intensity, same with intensity. If you have something that's like very dark pink and that's meant to show lots, and then something that's very light pink and it's meant to show little, okay, you can say that, but you can't be any more specific than that. You can't say that the dark pink is five times as dark as the light pink and expect somebody to process that. And then no quantitative perception, and I would add, so orientation, shape, enclosure, and added marks, these things that we put in order to convey some information, doesn't convey quantitative information. I would add to that color. Color is extremely good at focusing people's attention, it's good at communicating categories, not so good at communicating numbers or quantities. So here we have just kind of this similar thing, but according to a different data visualization book, this one put out by SAP, and it shows, like, again, how accurate we are at perceiving certain attributes and some how that others are less accurate. So again, position and length are, we very quickly perceive. You look at that, you know immediately that that black line is shorter than the other ones, and that it's almost, it's about half, right? Angle, we're not bad at showing. We're not bad at perceiving, but area, volume, saturation, so this differences in colors and hue, that's a lot harder for us to make comparisons about. So we use those to maybe define kind of categories or, but not necessarily to convey information that's quantitative. So I'll move on to design considerations. And then I promise we'll get into some visuals after and we'll kind of talk about them because that's the fun part. But before we do, and I hope you'll be able to remember some of this discussion about the pre-attentive attributes and the design considerations, because then when we're kind of talking about these graphs that we're going to be seeing, we'll talk about some of these things. So in the design considerations, one, I think this applies to everything that's visual, from a painting to a brochure to a graph, and that's using color, contrast, similarity, and white space strategically. The other stuff is a little bit more data specific. So aim for comparability. So what does that mean? People usually, when they're looking at quantitative data and they're asking themselves a so what question, it's because they want to compare it against something. And that's where it makes sense. So if you're saying, if you're saying like, oh, there's 60% of women are, you know, using the ER versus 40% of men, like, oh my gosh, right? But is it, oh my gosh, but what if you're in a community that's, what if it's the university hospital and it's 60% of women who attend it and 40, right? So it matters, like things matter only when you can compare them often to a baseline or, so one of the things, one of the big sins in data visualization is people manipulating where they start their graph. So not starting at a zero, and that makes it really hard to compare because we're used to things being scaled from zero up. So when we're measuring or comparing or trying to figure out where they are, we're intuitively sort of starting from a zero baseline. So when we don't have that, then things get trickier to compare, and then you get fuddled, and then you're not processing it as quickly. So be clear and legible, eliminate visual clutter. That includes things like background lines, like too many colors, these things that we often see in graphs that actually don't add anything to them and only make, like, take the focus away from the data you want to show. Simplicity, don't try to show too many things in one visual. I'm sure we have all seen a visual, including that one about the Bitcoin, where, you know, someone is trying to say five different things and you can't even get one thing across because it's all just cluttered. And then text. We seem to think that because if information is quantitative, that it needs to be conveyed in numbers and in graphs, and we don't want to use text. Whereas sometimes annotating your graph or chart with text makes it easier for the reader to to digest, to take in, to see how it's part of a narrative. And I don't think we should shy away from using text. So here we'll get into some examples right now. One of the things that I see often very poorly presented is demographic data. Right, so I pulled this off some random website, and where they're talking, I think it's people who made submissions to that website or something like that. And so it breaks them down by gender and age and education and human development index. And like, so quickly, can somebody tell me, you know, what the biggest age group is here? 16 to 30. Yeah, can you tell me how many roughly, like, are they half, are they three quarters? I mean, here it looks like they're just about over half. And then can somebody tell me what the education of, like, what the, you know, highest level of education that people have, or what the most biggest group? right? The colors are too. Yes. And here's a thing also with colors. So about 0.5% of women and 10% of men have an impairment in how they perceive color. So that whole thing about like wives picking up stuff for their husbands, or, you know, like ties to match their socks, or men being like very much not, that stereotype is based on this fact that in men it's much, much more common for them not to be able to distinguish between certain hues. There's like two different levels of color blindness. And so when you're using colors that are too similar and you're using too many of them like that, I mean, I don't know if any of you are colorblind, and it's really hard to see which, whether it's unknown or it's beyond secondary, that's the education. Right now, imagine you're colorblind on top of that, right? So you're not picking up, like there's certain cues that, or there's certain hues that you're not picking up. So certain softwares like Tableau, for example, and I'm not sure if Excel does this, probably not, but Tableau has a palette that's like a colorblind palette. Right, so you can, if you're using that palette, you're making sure that everybody who sees your visual is able to discern between those hues. But there's also websites online where you can upload your visual, and then it shows you how it's going to be seen through somebody who's colorblind. So then you can see if the message is still getting across or not. And I mean, that sounds trite, but 10%, that's 1 out of 10 of your male viewers, right? That's not, if you look at a room like this where there's probably was about 40 men, that means like 4 people aren't going to understand what you're saying just because you use a wrong hue. So, yes, yeah, so this is the reason why I think this data is presented very poorly is, you know, like you brought up, the colors, the fact that we don't process kind of the area very well, so it's hard for us to compare. And also this, like, going back to a legend, trying to find it and then trying to go back and match the colors, that takes a lot of processing power, right? And then in the end, you also are kind of like, well, so what? Right? So are somebody here overrepresented, underrepresented? Like, what are we, why are we seeing this data? So, what I did is, in order to kind of go through an example of how we can take kind of a bad visualization and make it into a better visualization, is I took some of our homeward trust zone data. So some of the demographic data. So I've got, we work with, we probably have about 1,800 people who are currently on our by names list, which is a registry of people who are currently experiencing homelessness. Most of them are chronically homeless, and a large part of them are matched to a program and are waiting to get in. So when I look, I take that kind of data set of people and I looked at, you know, what are some of their demographic characteristics, and I only looked at a couple. So here is their age. And so I first made a graph that is a default. I did a default Excel graph, which gave me a pie chart. And you know, the thing is, like, okay, this is extraordinarily bad, but yeah, you see this all the time. You know, you see this kind of thing all the time, like pie charts that show, and here you can't for the life of you tell who's got, like, which is the biggest age group, how old these people are, like, you, there's nothing you can tell. The colors are just all over the place. So then I'm like, okay, so I'll use some of what I know about pre-attentive attributes in order to make this data more legible. So I know, okay, if I want people to compare, I want to use bars, right? If I want to draw people's attention to say who the largest group is, I'll use color as a pre-attentive attribute. I want to declutter. I don't want to use too many colors to confuse them. So this is the graph, same information, right? Shown a different way. Now can anyone tell me what is the biggest age group? People, right. But the other ones are actually pretty close, right? So we see this bump. You can really quickly sort of see really it's between like 30 and 45 or 50 that kind of probably the majority of the population is. So I put this, I used this, like some design principles, some visual, some pre-attentive attributes, but it's still kind of unsatisfying. Like I'm still left looking at this and kind of saying like, okay, so what? Which leads me back to the second point in what we should be thinking about whenever we're doing a data visual, which is being mindful of the question that the data is meant to answer, or the story is meant to tell. Like, data for the sake of data, even if you have the demographic data, I think people are always also, people tend to be very much tempted to put demographic data in various reports because usually they have it. Because whatever data you are collecting, you're usually collecting demographic data. And so you think, well, I should put it, you know, and it lends itself very well to bars and graphs and it's numeric and it's data, right? Boss will like it. But, you know, unless it's communicating something, it's just real estate and it's just taking away from whatever you're trying to say. So I looked at our data and I'm like, okay, well, what would I like to know actually about the people experiencing homelessness? Well, really, I want to know how their age compares to the population, the general population. Like, are they younger? Are they older? Do we have an overrepresentation of a certain age among the homeless population? Like, that's really what I want to know when I look at the age. So then this is the visual that I came up with. And so the question, how does the age of the population experiencing homelessness compare to the general population? So as you go down, you see people experiencing homelessness is in orange, and the Edmonton area population in the 2016 census is in gray. And your first scan of this visual will tell you that they actually don't differ very much, right? You can very quickly compare. If you look really closely, you can see, okay, there's slightly more children, and then there's slightly less people who are a bit older. And the median age of the homeless population is a bit older. But, I mean, really, it's very close, right? So what I also done is I've consolidated some of the categories. Because do you need the five-year interval? Does it matter? Not really, right? You can just as well have the kind of the youth or the older people on each end by 10 years, and it tells the story, it answers the question, right, without minimizing sort of what you show. So this would be like what I would say, okay, if you're going to visualize demographics, like, you know, and here you're using text, right, and it's not offensive, it's just kind of like fills in a little bit of the context. So I've gone from a pie chart to a bar graph, which, is like kind of page one of every data visualization textbook. So that's maybe a little bit trite. So does that mean a bar is always effective? You know, no. I think it's very effective. And also I would caution against like, oh, I have too many bar charts. I'll just throw in like a pie or a 3D thing or something for just to be different, just so it's not boring. It's like, no, don't. Go with something that's effective rather than something that's novel. Because your whole point is just try to get a message across. So, okay, so if we look at the ethnicity of people, a population experiencing homelessness, I, knowing what I know about it, thought, how can I communicate this effectively not using a bar graph? And so I went back to our friend, actually, the pie, which I think is effective if you're only trying to show one thing. If you're trying to show like one part of the whole, not if you're showing like 10 categories, but here. So here, Indigenous people are 6% of Edmonton's population. Indigenous people are 57% of Edmonton's population. And then another 7 are unknown, so may also be Indigenous. Like this is pretty, you know, this tells you something dramatic about the differences in the population. Whereas in age, nothing dramatic was happening. Here, something dramatic is happening, but it's one thing, and one category, or I've reduced it to one category because I didn't put in, like, you know, other kind of ethnic nuances, because you're trying to get across one thing, right? And there you can use a pie and it's effective, right? Because you don't actually, because you're also using text to fill in that like 6 to 57. So you're not asking people to make that measurement, right? But you're trying to show like how one part of the whole is small and one part of the whole is big. So does that mean we always need a graph or a chart? No. Sometimes it means it's more effective not to have one at all. The thing with gender graphs, I find, especially if only two genders are being represented, is that they're usually super boring, like the one we saw back then, like, right? So if it's going to be boring, you might as well just use one number, right? Or like a sentence, or you get across the same information, you save on the real estate, you save on the cognitive power. So anyways, that's kind of all I had to say about this. I don't know if you guys have any questions or anything you wanted to talk about in terms of, you know, what you've seen in how data is used in your organizations or in your, please. Yeah, just talk into it. You won't hear yourself. That's okay.
So, you know, I just work with my computer, the programs that you have, and when you look at these wonderful data visuals, how can, like, when I use graphs at all, I just use Excel. But would you know of any other software that we can download for free? Because our section doesn't have budget for $1,000 software. That can also make. You know,
pretty visuals.
Pretty visuals too.
So I talked about Excel and us being bound to Excel's default charts, but everything I showed you was done in Excel. All the things I've done is in Excel. So it's just a matter of not being constrained by what Excel spits out the first time you say, like, insert a graph. A really good resource that I would point you to is a website called Storytelling with Data. I bought this woman's book and I listened to her podcast. I just love her. She's great. She used to work for Google, and she realized that a lot of the information and a lot of the analysis that her group was doing, and they were doing a lot of stuff in human resources, was just the message was not coming across to the managers, and she realized that's part of how they portrayed the message. So she started turning her attention more in how they were showing the data and what message they were trying to get across, and then she got a lot more traction in terms of what she was able to influence as the data analyst person, or as the person kind of running that shop, when she was able to show the information in a particular way. And so her big thing that she talks about kind of in her book and on her blog is to not be constrained by a tool. And so she does a lot of things. A lot of the stuff she does is in Excel, and also on that website, she's got a lot of Excel templates that she has for some kind of cooler looking charts that you don't know could be done in Excel. So yeah, go on the website, kind of, it's a blog, and she does these monthly kind of data viz competitions where she puts up a graph and has people around the world like redesign it, and so they send it. And then, like I said, she's good, she's got resources, she uploads these Excel templates that you can download and see how you can make a slope graph, how you can make, but yeah, generally there's also things that you can do in Excel in terms of just formatting your chart, like removing the lines in the background. You know, you just click on them and you can delete them, and that immediately makes your graph so much cleaner. Like, you almost never need those lines in the background. And you realize, like, when you start taking them away, like, why did I have them? And then they start bothering you when you see them, or like boxes, or like unnecessary lines. And you can just easily delete them and change the color scheme in Excel. Don't use that horrible like blue and orange thing that they always throw up, you know, like it's never a good idea. You know, what she recommends doing, and what I find is helpful, Like start every visual by being gray, and then think about what you want to like. So color everything gray, and then think about, so you have a bar chart, color it gray, and then think about what you're contrasting, what you're pointing to, that you want to color, right? And then that also forces you to think about what question you're asking or what you're trying to answer with that graph. So it is a good technique. So yeah, I mean, Excel is actually an amazingly versatile tool. I also use Tableau, but Tableau is a lot more, with Tableau you have to do a lot more work in getting your data set kind of in the right format for it to work. So I would say it's a little bit more of an involved program. I say if you already have like a baseline knowledge of Excel, it's the best thing you could do is probably just learn how to use that well. And like I said, that storytelling with data, it's a good website to start off with. You really get a lot of good information. So.
Thank you very much. That was really interesting. Yeah. And great that you did it all with Excel, because that's
that helps.
That's good to know. So I'm a quantitative researcher. I'm an epidemiologist. I do numbers, but I find that, I don't know if it's a shift in my own thinking or in general, and you kind of had that picture of Trump, but there's this, even more so than previously, a move away from statistics because anyone can use them however they want. You know, there's this fake news idea, and I just find that as a quantitative researcher, whatever findings are so much less, I don't know, taken up by people. And so I'm just wondering, this was very much quantitative. The study that we're doing now is in mixed methods and moving more into qualitative research. And even, I mean, with homelessness, I think, and the thing that this morning when we had to write down the one thing that we wanted, that we wished people knew, like I said, that we collect data and we generate statistics, but like no one person that we work with is a statistic. And I think that is there a way that, you know, when you look at your work and you see these percentages, that you can translate that into, and I mean, some of the work that Tara's done with the photo voice, and I love that, you know, that's a different data visualization technique in a way, but a qualitative data visualization. Just wondered if you had any thoughts about kind of the mixing of quantitative and qualitative in visualization.
Yeah, well, there's, so again, going back to just in this case, the name of that website that I told you guys, the storytelling with data, that concept, the storytelling with data concept, that's been getting more popular over the past couple of years as people have been finding exactly what you're finding. Like, there's just tons of numbers. You can go get numbers. They end up becoming sort of meaningless. You don't know what to compare them to. You don't know what the context is, right? And so in the people who are talking about this, this how to tell stories with data, which my presentation was like a little bit on that, right? But, and I drew from some of the work that those people do, like Cole Nussbaumer with that, from Google, like Stephen Wexler, who does the Big Book of Dashboards. Their whole thing is like, yeah, numbers don't. It's not the numbers that matters, or the data that matters. It's like the questions that you ask them, right, and the story that you tell around them. And that's this like use of kind of, you know, using text with your data, being super selective. Because I think also what's happened is because too much data has gone out there, like nobody's paying attention. So you actually have to be, and you have to, people can only take in a couple of numbers at a time. Like, I can sit here and probably spit out numbers, and you guys probably have all been to presentations where it's a very quantitative presentation, and you get to slide number 4 and you're like, it's like the 7th percentage they reference and the, you know, 4th number, and you're like, you know, I'm here, right? My glass is full in terms of what I can comprehend. So, I mean, without knowing the specifics of the research you're doing, I think what sticks in people's minds is like a story or a narrative, and if you can kind of incorporate numbers into that, I think it makes it stronger. I also, like, when I think about numbers, I think about it like it's like trying to feed vegetables to your kids. You know, it's easier when you're able to sort of sneak them in something that's good, right? It's a lot harder to, seriously, right? Seriously, it's a lot harder. Like, I can get my daughter to eat kale only when I put it into like a strawberry banana honey smoothie, right? Where she has no idea that it's there. It's yummy, right? So, and then she eats it and I feel, you know, very satisfied as a parent. But that's the same thing with numbers, right? If you're able to like sneak some numbers in there in with the, you know, strawberry banana smoothie. Again, not knowing the specifics of kind of the question that you're asking, but I think it's helpful to think of it in terms of like the numbers being the vegetables and trying to have like a few of them and be very pointed about where you use them and trying to kind of couch them in a narrative. Like, I find the qualitative stuff too, like sometimes I'm like, okay, but right, it's also not very convincing because you don't have anything to kind of back it up. But I think if you can combine them, that's where the power is.
Do you have some strategies that you might share around, so you've just done this report and you're taking that final look at it and ensuring that you're not just giving data for data's sake, or ensuring that the visualization is telling a story? Do you have strategies or questions you ask yourself at the end process?
Yes. I mean, I try to always, when I look at a graph or a chart, I try to ask myself, like, what question is this trying to answer? Like, I just got a report the other day and it's an evaluation of a program. You know, and it's very, like, the first couple of pages is like talking about the demographics of the people in that program. And I just kept on being like, who cares? Who cares? Who cares? Like, does any of this matter? How does this matter? Yeah, and so I think like that going through each visual and asking yourself, like, what question does this answer? Like, how does this further my narrative? Does this further my narrative? Because if it doesn't, it's taking away from it. So just keep the text, just forget it, right? If you can, like, that, if you're using that visual, like the 18-year-olds, you know, in three provinces and the 19-year-olds in seven, like, is that really more effective than you just saying, like, three provinces out of 10 have an age of 18 and the rest 19, like, there it is in a sentence. Took you probably less time to read it than to try to figure out what the heck that graph is trying to tell you, right? Another thing to do is to, and I've done that even, I do that with my presentations. I just bring in people, and I sometimes bring in people from other departments. Like, yesterday I brought the poor communications guy and the you know, our office administrator from the engagement department, and I made them sit through this. And they graciously, you know, sat through it, and their comments were wonderful, because I sometimes think that some of this stuff is so, and they're like, look, I can't even read your gray, like, it's too washed out, and it never even occurred to me. Or they're like, I didn't have any visuals in the first, I was just talking, and they're like, you're losing us, we're not listening to you, right? So I went and I found, like, that ugly, you know, like, 18 and 19 chart, and that's going to stick in your mind, right? You're going to be like, oh. Right? And that's like from the people who are not in my department, who haven't heard me talk about it, who don't know my philosophy. Aren't. So, yeah, I mean, getting other people's feedback is huge. Like, trying to, if you can get someone to actually listen to you or go through your stuff, like, with that critical thinking of, like, is this stuff make sense, right? Like, what does this chart tell you? Even had like the one chart I was going to show as an example, and I had one slide where I thought it was making this really good point, and then I asked those guys yesterday, I'm like, and the pre-attentive attribute is, and they're like, color, and it wasn't, like, I just used color to point to the attributes that were supposed to be quantitative, and then I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm wrong. Right? But like, I thought I was being super smart, and no, right? So it's just good to get that feedback. Yeah.
I mean, this is quite refreshing.
For, oh, good.
But I think it also, it to me, from it seems like there's a shift in how you present information, particularly information about social issues. Mm. To a certain extent, the person who presents the data must, like, say, well, so what? What does this data? What good is this data? You're talking about a certain position there, mm-hmm. right? So you're positioning, you know, the number of people mm-hmm. who are homeless as against the general population. So you're saying something here.
Yeah, you're
we need to
it.
Be concerned mm-hmm. because there is overrepresentation here. Mm-hmm. So as opposed to what we were traditionally trained to, you present data as they are. You're supposed to be neutral and objective. So I kind of, and well, I totally support this because I've worked in social development for many years, and I think data should take a certain position. I don't, well, that's my mm-hmm. personal, and that's my, that's just me.
Well, I could have shown mm-hmm. that graph in a different way. If we're looking at the ethnicity, I could have, say, chosen to show that we have an underrepresentation of immigrants and refugees within the homeless population as compared to the general population. If I was, you know, talking to an audience that cared about that thing. The thing is, though, you know, data doesn't speak for itself. You always have to ask it a question. And if you just throw up what you have, it's like nothing. Right, because nobody is going to, unless you, and another thing is too, not everybody is going to have the time to do what's called exploratory data analysis. So to look at these big data sets and to go through them. Like I've spent hours and hours going through and looking at things in a different way until like I see, oh, here's something that's different or that's odd or that we should look more into or that, proves or disproves a particular hypothesis that I have. And so the visualization is actually the result of that. So what you're also seeing in a visualization that, say, the one where I showed the ethnicity, well, that's a result of a whole bunch of analysis that I've already done with that data. And it's my judgment that this is the important thing because it's something that sticks out and that's relevant to the conversation. So you're always going to have that judgment, but what you also have is, like, you have to believe that the analyst is actually honestly looking at the data to begin with, right? And that they're able to. So, you know, I agree with you. Yes, you can't really visualize data because the question you ask, that already has some sort of ideological bent to it or a theory or you have a suspicion. You know, but there's no way around that unless I was going to throw up this data set of 1,800 people and the threat of whatever variables that each one of those entries have and be like, well, here you guys, here's the unbiased like data. And then in that case, it's still biased and clouded by the judgment of people because the way we collect the data and the way we ask the questions. And this is what's frustrating to me sometimes as an analyst is because I see that the questions were framed in such a way to get a particular answer. That's what's frustrating. You know, you see this, that's where I think it's, you know, that's where I'm more afraid of the ideological bent than on the analysis side, because someone else can take that data set and do something else with it if they've got a different hypothesis, position, angle. But if the data set, but the way the data set is, it's, you know, so it's almost like the, yeah. Definitely an ideological thing for sure. Definitely beliefs, definitely, you know, cognitive biases, theories on all ends of it. Anyways, thank you. We did get our 1 minute warning 5 minutes ago, so thank you very much.